So I understand I have a variety of backgrounds in the audience, and I'm hoping that you all had some exposure to at least pictures of the sun on the internet. And so that you might relate to the story I'm going to tell you. We are very lucky that we're able to work on things like this, you know, given the world such as it is and the issues of modern day life. We're still humans who are infinitely curious about the place we live. And so we get to have marvelous space missions like those from NASA and ESA. And these ones that I've been focusing on in the last decade or so have involved the sun and its effects on the interplanetary medium. And this is toward understanding, of course, effects on the planets as well as the intrinsic interest for the sun as a star. So you can go to the internet anytime and find a wealth of information, pictures of erupting coronas and high-resolution images that you can zoom in on and see incredible details. Spatial resolution is unprecedented in some of these. And wiggly lines, if you're interested in the parameters of the interplanetary plasma, the magnetic field, the density and velocity of what's flowing past the Earth all the time. But what is all this about? What's it telling us? And so what I'll give you is hopefully an updated view that you may not have from textbooks yet on what, how we understand what's determining what's around us in space. So the major contributing factor to heliospace, what's in the heliosphere, is the control by the surface magnetic fields on the sun. And now most people just think of these white light pictures with a few sunspots on them, and that's the end of it. The thing that you really want to look at if you want to appreciate the boundary condition on the heliosphere is a magnetogram. Now, a magnetogram is a picture, an image that's taken in the wings of spectral lines that are split by Zeeman splitting. And so they give an idea of the strength of the magnetic fields on this surface. And in a magnetogram, what you see is gray is very neutral, weak field, and you can see a sprinkling of black and white within the gray most places. The big black and white regions are the strongest fields, and they could be oriented with the radial components outward, which is, I believe, white in these images, and or inward, which is the black in the images. And you'll see that these active regions tend to have black-white pairs on them. And what we like to think of is that the background field with the weak field is the so-called quiet sun field, and then the strong fields are the active region fields. And then there are the polar regions, which you will see are particularly important in the overall heliospheric geometry. These are what establishes just about everything. If you did an end-to-end coupled model of what happens between the sun and the surface of the Earth, you could do all that modeling starting with this picture, basically, of the sun's magnetic field on the surface. Now, how do we understand these active region magnetic fields? They're the strongest fields, as I said, on the solar surface, hundreds to thousands of Gauss. And they tend to appear in these bipolar pairs, and sometimes it's a more complex configuration. And they appear in latitude bands, constant latitude bands, starting at about 35, 40 degrees. And those bands in both hemispheres progress equatorward as the solar cycle progresses, as the sunspot cycle progresses. And if you have a vector magnetogram, which some instruments can now use special techniques to draw out vector information, which gives the horizontal components as well as the radial components of these fields, you can see swirls and whirls. I think you can barely see these little arrows. But now we know that the fields in these active regions often tend to be twisted, especially when they're new. And there are a number of instruments now that routinely get these vector fields. Now, what we think is happening is that there are flux tubes or flux ropes under the surface of the sun that are erupting kind of like hernias through the surface and expanding into the relative vacuum of the space above it. And what they do is they make in a magnetogram for an active region these patches of outward and inward field at the legs of the hernia here. And then you can see that these things look like loops. You can actually see the rope in pictures such as the H-alpha spectral line. So there's a pretty good understanding of what you are looking at when you see an active region and what's going on in those stronger fields that are erupting. Behind the quiet sun fields, the salt and pepper fields, we think we understand, in fact, in quite detail, their relationship to what's called granulation on the sun. If you take a very high resolution white light image of the sun, such as this one, which was obtained on the ground, you can see the amount of detail here, and you can see the size of these cells is about 1,000 kilometers, so smaller than the diameter of the Earth, and they fill the quiet sun in the white light, and what they are is little circulation cells. Material flows up at the center of the cells, flows toward the edge, and falls down in the lanes between them. And they are organized into larger cells of supergranulation. And there's a depth to these that's expected to be about the same size as their horizontal scale. Now, there's a lot of motions that are seen also in the Doppler shifts the spectral lines on the sun. You can take what's called the Dopplergram of the sun in one of the spectral lines and see red and blue shifts. And what you end up is a picture that looks like the rind of an orange, except it's dark on one side and light on the other because there's a net rotation of the sun around its axis. But this small scale structure that you see in a Dopplergram is a reflection of this granular circulation, a small scale convection that's all over the photosphere. Now that is responsible, we believe, for these so-called quiet sun fields, these salt and pepper fields. If you take a very high resolution magnetogram, you can see spots of black and white, and they tend to concentrate in the boundaries of these smaller scale convection cells. And this quiet sun field is also what constitutes the polar region fields, except the polar region fields tend to have some net polarity. That means they tend to have more black or more white, and it tends to be opposite. And you can see that here in this averaging of the polar fields as a function of time over three sunspot cycles. North polar fields here have a cycle that goes from positive to negative with the sunspot cycle. And the south polar fields do the opposite. So you see they counteract each other in such a way that there's a dipole kind of behavior in the polar regions present, a global dipole present on a regular basis that flips every 11 years with the sunspot cycle. Now, the likely sources of all these fields are dynamos. And probably in your travels through physics courses, you might have run into the term dynamo and understand that it's conducting fluid motion. It generates magnetic fields, and it powers the magnetic field of the Earth and those planets that have magnetic fields. And also, we believe it powers the solar magnetic field that we see. And current dynamo theory is getting pretty involved thanks to helioseismology, which probes the interior of the sun. This is a cartoonized picture of the current dynamo picture. Has what a rigidly rotating radiative core inside the sun. There is a convection zone that's a bit more than a third of the way in and in thickness, and within that is there are convection cells, which are still being probed by helioseismology observations. And near the surface, there is this layer where the granulation pattern, the small scale circulation, is occurring on top of that. And what people think is that the, well, the researchers in the Dynamo, solar Dynamo area think is that there's big magnetic flux ropes that are generated probably in the deep convection zone near the boundary between the radiative core and the convection zone, where there's a high shear layer. There's a high velocity shear going on here. Because the core is rigidly rotating and the convection zone has its own mind and is in fact, we will see differentially rotating, the high velocity shear prompts the generation of these wound up magnetic fields that become strong enough eventually to make their way through the convection zone, and although they fragment along the way, they appear on the surface presumably as the active regions that we see, and those who come poking through the quiet sun fields. So that the field on the surface, if you want to make a cartoon version of that, looks quite complex. You've got this layer of granulation-generated dynamo fields. These tiny little arcades are to represent little bipoles that the granulation cells make. And then poking out of them are these fields that are coming from the deeper convection zone, and they are the stronger ones, and they can be wound up to various degrees. And these are interacting. The small scales and the large scales, the fields interact. You might have heard the word reconnection in space physics lectures before. And by interacting, they small scale fields can in fact help erode the large scale fields and cause them to decay and tear apart. But there are also large scale surface motions on the sun that help that decay of the emerged active. And that includes differential rotation. If you observe features on the sun, you find that the equatorial features move faster than the polar features. The average rotation rate of the sun is 27 days, 27.3 days. The equator might be rotating around 25, and the polar regions around 30. So you have a velocity shear just from this differential rotation that such that if an active region is spanning latitudes, it gets torn apart over time. There's also, by feature tracking, what's called meridional flow. There seems to be a general motion toward the poles of features from the equator. And the way that that circulation closes inside of the convection zone is still unclear, and it is central to dynamo theory. So people are working very hard to understand it. So you have the fusion caused by the interaction of the small scale and large scale fields, tearing those active regions apart. You have the differential rotation of the surface, shearing them and tearing them apart. And you have the meridional flow spreading toward the poles. And it's by virtue of the active regions tilts that we get these net polar fields that are positive or negative. It's a very interesting process. So the net result of all this, if you look at a time-lapse picture of the, this is a global picture of the sun's field put together by taking these fovis magnetograms over a 27-day period and pasting them together in such a way that you get not exactly a snapshot of the global field of this latitude and longitude in this synoptic display of the sun's field, but it's almost a snapshot, especially when things are slowly evolving. And you can see these are fresh active regions, and then you can see the decayed active regions here that look like little chevrons. This is a fairly quiet period that we're looking at in the beginning of 2000, or this is the middle of 2008 now. We went through a long solar minimum, and the active region activity was modest. And as you will see, we were lucky and it finally picked up. But nevertheless, the active regions do evolve in such a way that they feed this quiet sun field through their decay, and they also feed the polar fields of the sun. But a lot of people run around who think about the sun and the sun's field or stellar fields run around thinking of dipoles, dipolar fields, you know, positive on top and negative on the bottom. This, if you look at it, does not look like a dipole field. It's a field that has a lot of high order moments, that are produced by the fact that the strong fields are really in these active regions that are concentrated and changing in latitude all the time. So here's a better picture to look at for a perspective on what the solar cycle does to these synoptic views. These three top panels are three synoptic maps of sequential solar rotations for near solar minimum period. You can see it's dominated by quiet sun field. You can see this little white bias on the top and a little black bias on the bottom. Here, the active regions are beginning to emerge at a latitude of about 35, 40 degrees. And here, they've slightly moved toward the equator, but they're really getting to be much stronger near solar maximum. And you can see these chevron-like patterns while they're decaying through the differential rotation and the diffusion and the meridional flow that's going on. So that is the boundary condition on the entire heliosphere. Now, related to all these fields is the heating of the corona. And I think everyone has now agreed that the corona of the sun, the atmosphere of the sun, is heated some way in these fields. But if you look at science and nature, you will see that the coronal heating problem has been solved about twice a year for the last 5 years. And so there are many things that are going on, and the observations show a richness of behavior. But I would argue that we don't really understand the details of this. We know that there are many ways the corona is being heated, and maybe it's the case that that's the answer. So somehow that all works out to produce these beautiful soft X-ray images in this case, or extreme ultraviolet images that you find on the web. Here's a sequence of magnetograms that goes from an active period to solar minimum back to an active period. And the corresponding Yoko soft X-ray images, you may have seen this plot before. And you can see the corona is bright and busy and has all these loops and bumps in X-rays and dark spots at solar maximum. And it gets very dark in the X-rays at solar minimum and very bright again at solar maximum. So that is a case in point where the solar magnetic fields are in fact heating the corona some way and producing all of the structure that we see associated with these bright loops above the active regions principally. And if you go further out in the corona, you see the same kind of thing happening over the solar cycle. During the absolute solar minimum, you might have a corona that, if you squint your eyes, looks almost like it has two lobes here, like a dipole field. These dark regions are fields that open out into interplanetary space that coronal holds. During solar maximum, when there's more active regions present, or on the rising and declining phases, you get something in between. You see a much busier looking coronal picture. There are many loops that are there in many open and closed field region transitions. These things that you see that seem to come out of the lobes of the dipole here and these other structures, these other loops, are coronal streamers. And they're defining the largest closed magnetic field regions in the sun. So what's new? STEREO mission has emphasized the 3D aspects of the sun. STEREO, if you haven't heard about it before, is a two spacecraft mission. It went up in late 2006 and really started its mission in early 2007. Two spacecraft were launched and then used the moon's gravity assist to jettison them head and behind the Earth in the Earth's orbit. They do that by one being slightly inside and one being slightly outside. And so we cleverly name them ahead and behind, because one is moving ahead of the Earth in its orbit and one is lagging behind the Earth in its orbit. And they drift at about 22 degrees a year. You can see these year markers here. And what the whole idea was to image and also take in-situ measurements of the solar wind, solar plasma that was blowing out from the sun in order to gain a much better idea of the 3D corona and heliosphere rooted in that corona. Unfortunately, when Stereo arrived on orbit, the sun had entered a very long solar minimum. And we had, in large part, been after the active sun and all of its glorious eruptions. But it ended up being a very interesting minimum just the same. And besides, you see here around late 2009, 2010, we finally started recovering the level of sunspot and therefore coronal activity. But more than that, by then Stereo had separated enough so that the images obtained by Stereo behind, Stereo ahead, combined with images from the Earth, now from the Solar Dynamics Observatory, were enough to make snapshots. They were really snapshots of the corona at a certain time. And these are regularly pasted together and posted on the Stereo Science Center. So if you would like to know what the sun is doing today, what it looks like today, you can go to the Stereo Science Center and get a movie that looks like this. And I think there's even an app that you can install on your cell phone to really know what the dark coronal holes are doing and what the bright active regions are doing in the solar corona and what's facing the Earth at the time. So what is this told us? Well, one of the most striking things to me has been the fact that when I went to school and learned about the sun and the sun's field and the solar wind, this was the picture I was always given. A picture of a dipolar corona and a polar hole, polar coronal hole, solar wind flowing out of it. And this was sold as being a pretty general picture, and the dipole tilted as the sunspot cycle went on, but this was the way it always was. But in fact, it's not. And the corona, especially recently, has been incredibly complex. This is a challenge, but it's also interesting. And that's because the solar field is not a dipolar field. It's a field that's full of higher order moments that creates open and closed field regions that are much more distributed around the sun. So for example, we might still have something that looks like this equatorial streamer belt associated with the polar field component of the sun, but we also have streamers sticking out in random places that are dictated by the presence of the magnetic fields from the active regions, which introduce higher order moments into the solar field. And that also introduces coronal holes, open field regions, sources of solar wind at low and mid helio latitudes that can be major sources of solar wind that affect the Earth and the planets. And this is a picture that is really quite ubiquitous and something that needs to change in textbooks because this is the way it is. And we better get used to it because I think it's here to stay for a long time. Sun's field has had a trend toward complexity. The other thing that you can do if you're interested in the coronal structure that goes with a particular map of the sun's field at the time is visit a website such as this one from the Global Oscillations Network Group, where they solve for the coronal field geometry based on this picture of the surface field. And what they use is something called a potential field source surface model, sorry about the spelling, which is a very nice model. It's a simplified model, a step up from a dipole, where you can put any synoptic map down at the base of the corona, and you assume the solar field goes radial at a few solar radii, and you solve basically for that vacuum field inside of that volume with a Laplace equation and spherical harmonic expansion. And what you get is something that actually looks like the solar field at the time. And the main feature that most people home in on is this blue feature, which is called the main streamer belt. This call it streamer belt because it goes all the way around the sun. And then you have with the red and the blue patches, the open and closed field regions of coronal holes, including the isolated low-latitude and mid-latitude holes. And then there are these patches that you won't find colored in the gong plots, and that's because there are these things called pseudo-streamers Now, pseudostreamers don't have this donut-shaped behavior around the sun. They're isolated streamers that look more like a minaret or a Hershey's Kiss. They're self-contained. And they have a footprint here that's not rendered and colored in these images. So anytime you see that, if you visit a potential field model, those are the big footprints of pseudostreamers. And for example, in this case, the pseudostreamer was aimed right at the observer. So what we can do with this 3D model of the coronal field based on the solar surface field is to compare with the images that we get from stereo of behind, ahead, and the Earth's view. And in this case, they were all very close together at the beginning of the mission, and the sun was still pretty quiet. So we did have some warping of the streamers of the sun, and we did see these large coronal hole features, which were showing up in the potential field model where the solar wind was presumably coming from at low heliolatitudes. Latitudes. But now, and for a long time before now, the situation has been much more extreme, and you can hardly say that that looks like a dipole if you're doing modeling or doing some kind of approximating. And here, in fact, is a big open field region of coronal hole that's facing the Earth perspective, which you can see here in the model, and that is supplying the bulk of what's affecting us here on our planet. So the availability of these various viewpoints and the availability of the magnetic field data with which to make models like this combined gives you a perspective on the 3D structure of the corona and what's coming out of it that is something quite different from what the usual textbooks show. So these models can also be used to estimate the sources of solar wind at any time. You can make a line around the boundary of the potential field model near the ecliptic plane, and here's the Earth here, and there's little black dots which are stereo ahead and behind. And map field lines, map open field lines from those locations back to the surface of the sun to see which feature is feeding plasma out into the ecliptic plane at the time, or out to stereo A or out to stereo B. And the red and the green are just color-coded by whether that open field is outward or inward. What you find when you watch this is that you're disconnecting from the poles most of the time. As soon as the active regions start appearing, and this is looping from the solar minimum at the beginning of the mission to this active time of the present time, and you can see that all these are rooted now in these low latitude open field regions. So it's not a polar hole solar wind that we have most of the time. Here's another view of that, looking down on the North Pole through a transparent sun. And here we're having polar winds, and now we're not. You can see the foot points are all attached to low latitudes. And even though you might have what looks like a 2 or 4 sector structure if you're sampling on a spacecraft in the ecliptic plane, it's not coming from the poles. It's coming from the low and mid latitude extensions. So what does this mean? All this busyness, all this. These different solar wind sources are in fact producing a very non-uniform interplanetary medium. All of the solar plasma, all of the coronal material that's flowing out of the open field regions at different velocities is doing things like colliding with each other. Streams are moving slower or faster, and a faster moving stream can overtake a slower stream, especially given the rotation of the sun in such a way that ridges, spiral-shaped ridges will form everywhere there's an interface between two different source region rooted flows. And we've been able to see these thanks to stereo visually. Stereo has an unusual imaging system whereby not only do they have coronagraphs focused on the sun to give us 3D images of coronal loops, but they have these side-looking telescopes called heliospheric imagers. There's one set that looks to the sides like this, and one set that looks out even further. So you can imagine two other V-shaped cones going even further out. all the way out to the orbit of Earth, we can, in faint white light, image structure now, something that's unprecedented. And what those heliospheric imagers often show are these, if you take sequential images and you subtract them to get what's called a difference image, you see these long ridges of dark and light coming out of these from the white light difference images that suggest there are compressions and rarefactions in the medium that's flowing out, and they're quite extensive. The sun is in the middle here. These are just two of the heliospheric imager fields of view, and the Earth is out here. But these are ridges in the solar wind that actually can be matched to the occurrence of high-density structures that reach the Earth. With the stream, the interfaces of the solar wind that we detect in situ with plasma and field instrumentation. So STEREO has enabled us to now understand how all this complicated structure and all these solar wind sources are mapping out into the heliosphere and giving us some of the structured behavior, the high densities, the high velocities, and low velocities of the solar wind that is affecting us. And exists throughout the solar system and throughout the heliosphere. But more than that, the heliospheric images are also showing that there's a lot of blobs and globs of a smaller scale that are coming off, and many of them seem to be coming off the Helmut streamer belt. If you take the different views of the Helmut streamer belt, and you take different views of these blobs from STEREO A and B, these are two pairs, a structure that's coming off that looks like a jet on one image, on the other view from the other STEREO will look like an arc. And that probably is meaning that something like this is going on, where perhaps the end, the cusp point of this Helmut streamer belt somehow got disconnected, something we in space physics would call a plasmoid, or a flux rope perhaps. Whereas looking at the other view, this thing seems to have an extension along the streamer belt as if it has some length. So this blob wind is something that seems to be ubiquitous. And these two views with the coronagraph on STEREO show a solar minimum, solar wind, that's constantly shedding blobs and globs. The solar wind is not a steady stream. It's got a lot of transient structure. It's got a lot of activity, even in the quietest situation. And this is a heliospheric imager difference image for a similar quiet period. You can see that it's not a laminar flow. It's got plenty of structure. It's full of transient activity. So steady state models are looking less and less desirable from a predictive standpoint in terms of understanding our solar wind and our space environment. We also see transients in situ. If you look at our Wiggly line in situ data at magnetic fields and velocities and densities and temperatures, it's hard for you to see, but we can identify with these vertical lines, delineating them in this case, signatures if we zoom in of small, what we think are small transients that are coming by. Here's a magnetic field plot of the three components of the field, and you can see this piece of magnetic field distinguishes itself somehow by producing something that actually might be modeled by a small flux rope in some cases. And there are signatures like a low beta period here. And there are signatures like cold proton temperatures and counter-streaming electrons sometimes. So we're finding that in the regular old solar wind, there are many signatures that are suggestive of non-steady behavior. And why be surprised? If we have this constantly evolving boundary condition on the sun, why would we expect it to be a steady outflow? There must always be reconfiguration of the coronal fields in response to the boundary. And therefore, what's coming out in the course of those reconfigurations, we must experience, especially in the ecliptic plane where we're intersecting that streamer belt structure all the time. Now, there are other transients, of course. And we were fortunate to have a pickup in the solar activity. You heard coronal mass ejections, which are the large explosions of the corona. And those are probably the largest of the transients, if you think of a continuum of transients in the coronal reconfigurations. The CMEs, the coronal mass ejections, may be the largest of those. And that's because they could be in response to major changes required in the coronal configuration by the relaxation of newly emerged, really wound up fields, or the rearrangement of structure due to the evolutionary process that all of a sudden requires a large change. So they must involve opening up of new coronal flux and closing down of new coronal field lines, new coronal flux, and also the relocation of the open flux from one location to another to make it compatible with the boundaries and combinations thereof. So we have this situation where the coronal field is always trying to catch up with its boundary condition, and it never quite makes it. Now, we know that these larger eruptions can take many forms, and as I was mentioning, there's active region associated fields that probably come out very wound up and produce a disequilibrium in the corona that causes an eruption of the structure in order for it to try to achieve a better state. There's probably quiescent adjustments that are occurring in these. We have what's called a streamer blowout event that just seems to be a quiet expansion of part of the closed field of the corona. We have these old active regions that get sheared by the differential rotation that then form filaments on the sun and eventually erupt with the filament. So there's many ways that the corona can change. And we know for a fact that if you look at the complex field geometry of the corona and its association with the active regions, that there are many kinds of interconnections that occur. And in fact, there are some interconnections that are so complex between active regions by different field networks that once in a while you get what looks like a global event where the whole corona just seems to not know how to connect itself. And it's just undergoing a massive rearrangement. And we have all these pseudo-streamers. Here's a particular pseudo-streamer that showed up in the potential field model and achieved a very large size, and there was in fact a coronal mass ejection in this difference image, which is not a movie, that occurred going right out in this direction where this very large pseudo-streamer grew up. So the fact that we have pseudo-streamers, which is a sign of complexity, may also mean that we have a lot more potential for eruption of closed field regions into coronal mass ejection. And this is exactly what is said here. Now, many of these may be directed toward high latitudes because a lot of the pseudo-streamers are out of the ecliptic, but they could be anywhere. And as you saw, pseudo-streamers may be facing you. Now, as far as the coronal mass ejections go, stereo imagers provided these wonderful panoramas that we never had before going from the pictures, EUV pictures on the sun, the coronagraphs, the heliospheric imager 1 and the heliospheric imager 2, all the way out to the Earth, basically we could take pictures. And these are available to you on the web in their full glory. And we can even watch the activity of eruptions in this panoramic view. Of course, this is looking to the side, so it's really a wraparound in this upper picture. So here's the innermost sun picture you can see, the heliospheric imager, inner in red and outer in blue. And these are just the two coronagraph viewpoints from the same. So we have an ability to really put together the 3D situation on the eruption of these coronal mass ejections. So what about the in situ consequences, the things that really come to greet us here at the Earth and say, here we are, respond to us. what the traditional picture has been for decades and decades has been this very simplistic eruption of a so-called flux rope into the surrounding interplanetary space with a sometimes a leading shock ahead of us if it's moving faster than a few hundred kilometers per second ambient solar wind flow, and driving the shock means that there are sources of energetic particles and so forth. And in situ pictures showed the pile up of the solar wind ahead of us and the densities and temperatures, and then you would see this magnetic field signature of what looked like a flux rope. And so we thought, well, we really understand that. But now we have these multi-point measurements on a routine basis. And we, at Berkeley, who have the in-situ experiments on stereo, post these. This is in real time. If you want to know, is there a solar energetic particle event going on today at the Earth or at Mars, you can go into this site and you can see where the stereos are located and where the planets are located. And you can look at the solar activity and you can see the real-time pictures. These are mirrored from the NOAA Space Weather Prediction Center site of what stereo B energetic particles, A energetic particles, and the ACE spacecraft you're all seeing at the time. And you can also choose to see plasma data or other data as well. So this ability is unprecedented in terms of in-situ multi-point diagnosis of what's happening in the 1AU orbit of the Earth. Now, so when we try to reconstruct what CMEs look like with the flux rope picture, and we have multi-spacecraft observations, as this study by Mostel at Jade, which was recently published, shows. Here we have a situation where we've tried to fit flux rope models to the magnetic fields that were measured on the individual spacecraft. And we even had measurements on MESSENGER approaching Mercury, and we had measurements on the Venus Express spacecraft. So we had even more than the stereo and the Earth measurements here. And even though this was a complicated period with probably multiple coronal mass ejections going on, you can look at these closely spaced ones that are circled and thought to be from the same event. And it's hard to reconstruct that simple picture. You basically get structures that are distorted, contorted, tilted out of the plane in various ways that are different on closely spaced spacecraft. So this this canonical simple view of what a coronal mass ejection looks like in interplanetary space is probably not generally a very good one. It's a lot more complicated. Now the statistics of coronal mass ejections is interesting, in particular because we thought with the long solar minimum when stereo went up that we were actually entering longer minimum, which is a spotless period that may last for decades and even a century or two. Fortunately, the coronal mass ejection activity picked up, and this is the count rate of the interplanetary coronal mass ejections that were detected, have been detected in the past cycle and starting up in this new cycle. And we're about on track with the frequency of activity now. And so we feel that we have a lot to look at to understand. Now you'll see that most coronal mass ejections here, these are mean velocities, are pretty modestly moving. The solar wind speeds are usually between 350 and 800 kilometers per second, and it's pretty much the mean speed of coronal mass ejections. It's just that they're usually expanding and really special in the effects that they produce. But once in a while you get a really special event. And so Stereo A surprised us on July 23rd, 2012. We had, heading toward Stereo A, a CME whose speed on the sun was 3,500 kilometers a second. The in-situ speed of the solar plasma detected at 1AU by Stereo A was at least 1,400 kilometers per second. Was a huge solar particle event, and interplanetary fields of greater than 100 nanoteslas. Now, there is a famous solar event called the Carrington Event, which is thought to be the granddaddy of all solar events that have affected the Earth in the past, and seems to have produced a gigantic magnetic storm and all of its effects, but it was before the age of modern technology. So we didn't really, you know, telegraphs went on, you know, caught fire, and fire started some places for other reasons having to do with currents induced on the Earth. But of course, we had none of these space assets that we have. We don't rely on our cell phones and GPSs so closely. So it wasn't so highly noticed. Had this event hit the Earth, rather than Stereo A, which was about 135 degrees away around the backside, we would have seen it in the newspapers. We would have heard about it, and we might have gotten a lot of new funding. So whereas many people say, thank heaven it missed us, I'm disappointed that it missed us. I think it would have been a great thing for people to notice the fact that we do live in a larger space other than what we see in the sky above, or in the daytime atmosphere, and that the sun is not just that plain old yellow disk. Something more is there. So bottom line, so we've learned a lot about the solar connections of the environment that we live in the last half century. The internet has been great at making things accessible to people, everyone from this artists interested in the beautiful pictures to scientists trying to mine observations, interpret them, understand them. And of course, all of this has been a tremendous sustained effort on the part of people and agencies. And I hope it continues for a while. It looks like we are on track with the resources we have and some that are coming. This should be a very exciting time for all those who choose to work in this area.